spring is one of my preferred seasons for grafting. The rootstock buds start to swell up and the young leaves start to grow, which is a sign that the rootstock is waking up and the sap is starting to flow. In this season, I mostly use dormant scions and graft them into waking up rootstocks. If the rootstock is waking up and the scion is still dormant, you can be sure that the scion doesn't dry up before the graft tissues have a chance to heal. Using this approach will increase the percentage of graft success. In the spring, I mostly use three grafting techniques: the modified cleft graft, the whip and tongue, and the bark graft. All these techniques have their strong points and they all have a very high percentage of success. So, how do I choose which of these grafting techniques is the best for each situation? Let's see a few grafting examples and you will see how I make my choice. The type of rootstock you are using is very important to decide the right grafting technique for the job. Young potted rootstocks are usually quite thin, and the very thin bark won't allow the use of the bark grafting technique. So, you are left with the modified cleft graft, which I prefer to use when the scion is of a smaller diameter than the rootstock. If the scion and the rootstock are identical in diameter, the best technique is the whip and tongue. You can also use the cleft graft as an alternative. But whip and tongue has more cambium contact points and it rarely fails. So, although a bit more difficult to execute, I prefer to use it instead. When using rootstocks that are 2 years old or more, the difference in diameter to the scion is much bigger, so the whip and tongue technique will not be an option. The cleft graft tends to leave a gap in the middle of the rootstock in most cases, even when using 2 scions. So, I tend to choose the modified cleft graft or the bark graft instead. Usually, the modified cleft graft is my preferred choice. Since the bark is still too thin in most fruit types to be able to use the bark graft effectively. If you try to use it, the bark won't be able to support the scion and the graft will probably fail. The modified cleft graft adapts quite well to different grafting situations, as you can choose the best place to make the cut, so the scion and rootstock have a better chance to adjust. Even when you leave the scion in the middle of the cut, the bottom back cut makes a good cambium contact, so this grafting technique just works in these situations. With older rootstocks, like when you are changing varieties in planted fruit trees, the choice is clear. The bark grafting technique is the best one for the job. You can cut a few large branches and graft each one, leaving an earth branch for sap flow. Or you can cut the rootstock at a lower point and graft the main trunk. Whichever the choice, this technique is easy to do and works quite well for these larger diameter rootstocks. All the usual requirements of graft protection and graft follow-up should be used to ensure graft success. In most cases, the grafts will start growing after 3 or 4 weeks. The protection should start to be removed at this point so the buds can get enough sunlight. Leave it in place for a couple more weeks if the scion doesn't show signs of waking up. If you need more information on each grafting technique used in this video, be sure to check my channel. I have several videos that show each technique and where I talk you through every detail. This video is one of the best regarding the modified cleft graft. As for the bark grafting technique, this one has 8 grafting examples across several different fruit types. Regarding the whip and tang technique, this old video that I recently updated is still the best. These videos require lots of time and effort to make. Show me your appreciation by liking the video and leaving a comment. Share the video, and if you haven't already, consider subscribing the channel to help me make more videos. Thanks for watching.